Beneath the surface of our aquatic environment lies a captivating world, a biological richness that remains largely unseen by the naked eye. Imagine being able to uncover, from just a single drop of water, the diverse species that inhabit a water body. This possibility, far from science fiction, is now a reality thanks to environmental DNA. A field studied by the Ichthyology Department at the Royal Ontario Museum. Let's dive into the work of this team of researchers, whose expertise in decoding biodiversity fuels our hope of preserving our Great Lakes and rivers.
My name is Evan Hessels, and I'm a graduate student researcher here at the Royal Ontario Museum.
My name is Nathan Lujan. I'm the associate curator of fishes here at the Royal Ontario Museum.
Tobit Lianja. I am a fish biologist in the Royal Ontario Museum.
I work under Dr. Nathan Lujan.
I'm also working in collaboration with Dr. Lujan.
I would go on to discover new species and unlock secrets of evolutionary relationships, and now developing new tools that allow us to use DNA to understand the distribution and the diversity of fishes more easily.
The work of these scientists is crucial for cataloging biodiversity. The environmental DNA technique they are developing is becoming a key tool for addressing the challenges of ecological monitoring.
Basically, you're able to collect DNA from specimens, sequence a section of this DNA, and compare that to a known section. Using that, you can identify what species there are.
We can now take a single water sample, just take some water and filter it, and in that water sample are cells that all of us, all organisms, are constantly shedding into the environment. And those cells contain DNA, the DNA of the organisms that shed those cells, and those are unique signatures that identify those species. And so now we have the ability to sequence all of the DNA in a single water sample and use that DNA to identify all of the species that live upstream from there. This is really a game changer, a really amazing new technology.
Species are threatened by habitat loss, overexploitation, and water pollution.
We are losing, in many respects, the battle against the threats to that biodiversity. So we're trying to increase the knowledge of that diversity to quantify how many species are out there and how many need protection. And at the same time, there are increased threats to that diversity. So there are hydroelectric dams, there's a lot of gold mining going on, there's rapid deforestation, there's over-exploitation of these resources. These are all threats to that biodiversity that is important to all of humanity. And so we need to develop new tools that give us more rapid understanding of what species occur in a given area and where they occur so that we can prioritize conservation.
Back at the Royal Ontario Museum, our researchers, equipped with new samples, are on a mission to catalog the unseen and protect biodiversity before it slips away from us.
The challenge is that we have the ability to sequence all that DNA, but in the tropics, in any really biodiverse ecosystem, we're lucky if we can identify 20% or so of the sequences in a given water sample, because we just don't have the reference libraries to identify the rest of those sequences. They're sequences of DNA, and we know they belong to maybe a fish, but we don't know what fish they belong to what species they belong to.
There's not a lot of resources. It's still really new, and it's only as good as what's been developed so far.
If you want to use the DNA method, you need good barcoding libraries. So my work as a taxonomist is to provide accurate description of those species in order to make them easily identifiable. But if I can easily identify a species, then I can sequence its DNA and create what we call a barcoding that can be used to identify that organism in the future. Georgiana Mace, who is one of the sharpest minds in conservation biology, will say that we cannot expect conserving or protecting species that we cannot identify.
In pursuit of knowledge, our scientists are diving into the rich waters of South America and into the deepest river in the Congo.
So a lot of the work that my lab has been doing over the past few years in collaboration with colleagues in Peru and Ecuador is building up a reference database for the Western Amazon.
So my main goal is to build a reference database that's well curated and it's really fully complete, as best as I can anyways, in South America, where really very little research has been done.
We're talking about a globally unique level of freshwater diversity here, and we're going right into that most diverse area to collect as many fishes as possible from as broad a diversity as possible, cataloging the characteristics that identify them and putting as best as possible a name on each of those fishes. Part of the process of building this environmental DNA reference library is sampling biodiversity. Those specimens, they will remain open to examination, open to study by future generations as a snapshot of how biodiversity looks in time.
The intensive research conducted over the past decades has resulted in the creation of a rich collection preserved by the Royal Ontario Museum.
We have one of the largest collections of fishes in the world, a collection of 1.5 million fishes, and one of the largest collections of genetic samples in the world, over 44,000 tissues of fishes from all over the world, over 2,000 species. Yeah, sometimes the DNA comes back and it tells us that what we thought we were looking at doesn't really match up. And so we have to go back. And one of the really special features of working in a museum like this is we can go back to the specimen. We can hold that specimen in our hand and look more carefully and see things that we might have missed the first time.
When I got my results in for my eDNA, it's really, really cool to see. You get this giant spreadsheet and there could be over 100 fish species detected in just a liter of water, and it's pretty incredible to see.
By working in collaboration with international teams, I had access to facilities and cutting-edge technology that I didn't have access when I was in the Congo. Having those people around you as your mentors, as people guiding you, was really beneficial for my research.
Since nature knows no borders, it is essential to transcend boundaries to ensure promising conservation projects. As research progresses, one thing becomes clear: the necessity to build and maintain strong reference resources.
The next step is to continue building reference libraries. We need more work like this.
We really need more taxonomists, not less.
There are opportunities out there, and I think going forward there are going to be more opportunities as humanity as a whole recognizes the importance of biodiversity and of nature and of ecosystems to their own health. We're going to be needing more dedicated conservationists, biodiversity scientists going forward.
We are now able to quickly identify the presence of invasive species in a given aquatic compartment, providing that these species have been previously identified. However, the persistent threat of climate change demands continuous vigilance.
Earth is the only planet in the known universe that has life. And this diversity is the fruition of that life. And so it falls on humanity, who dictate the terms of planet Earth, to decide to prioritize biodiversity conservation. And there is a growing awareness of the threat that the biodiversity is facing and the need to invest more in its protection.
We cause a lot of issues globally, and we should be the one to clean them up and stop them really as soon as we can.
Our story ends here, but the action remains timeless. Since it's never too late to undertake what hasn't been started, it is now imperative that we unite on a global scale to protect nature, a responsibility that concerns us all.
We need to do our job and document and better understand and to be able to conserve things well.